Our guest today is Pat Wadors, who serves as Chief People Officer of UKG. Pat oversees talent acquisition and development, compensation and benefits, employee listening and people analytics, employee communications, HR technology, HR business consultants, and shared services, as well as components of workplace services and physical security. Known for transformational and strategic HR leadership, Pat believes that organizations thrive when they have a blend of people with differing backgrounds and ways of thinking, and who feel they belong as a contributor to the company's success. As a recipient of the National Diversity Council's Top 50 Most Powerful Women in Technology multiple times, Pat has served on the board of several prominent technology companies and is a frequent speaker on human capital management and diversity and inclusion issues. Prior to UKG, Pat served as CPO of Procore Technologies and has held multiple leadership roles at ServiceNow, LinkedIn, Plantronics, and Yahoo. So welcome, Pat Wadors. Did I get the last name right, the pronunciation?
Yes, you did. Thank you.
You know, that's a thing to check, right? Sometimes. Thank you. People have a hard time with Kahnweiler, but I try to help them with it. So thrilled to have you here today, Pat, in discussion about a topic we both feel I know so passionately about. I've been tracking your career over the years, and I love watching your updates on LinkedIn and actually where you worked at one time, right?
Yeah, I ran HR for LinkedIn for a number of years.
That's right. That's right. So I guess I'd like to start out with something that struck me when I was doing my research before this interview or discussion. And that was, I looked at your bio and on the left-hand side, I noticed it said, I think it said, Pat is an introvert. As an introvert in a leadership role, Pat is an advocate for results over talk and works feverishly to embrace the quieter voices.
Yes.
So I am really surprisingly pleased. I'm not surprised at it because if I could just give a little context here, you know, I've been in this space for a long time and it was up until recently, you know, we're sort of now getting the ear of C-level or senior level leadership and even talking about this topic. So I'm thrilled and kudos to you. Those of you who can't see, I'm clapping. But Pat, could you clarify, just explain a little bit about why you put that on there and what your thoughts are about proclaiming your advocacy or your introversion?
Probably two things were catalysts for me. One was when I was an up-and-coming manager, mid-management level, I was struggling with influence management. And so I was in semiconductor at the time. I probably had 20, 30 people under my remit in terms of influence and guiding and trying to do these big initiatives. And there were about 10 folks that just struggled with me. And they all came from different walks of life. It was my issue. They had nothing in common but me. And so I'm like, all right, tell me what's wrong. So I had a coach. I'm like, find out what's wrong. Just interview these 10 folks. I think something's off and I don't know what that is. And they're like, let's do a 360. Let's interview everyone. I'm like, no, I have a problem here. I just don't know what it is. Let me uncover that. And what it was, Jennifer, is basically that they didn't trust me. Like if when I was in town, I was quiet. I'd say good morning. And then how are you? And I'd walk by or maybe not even say hi. I'd eat lunch by myself. They'd invite me to social hours. And I probably the worst of the worst was like, yeah, I'll meet you there and never show up. And you know, I was in my head a lot. And so they misinterpreted as if I didn't like them, didn't respect them, like, you know, name your adjective. And the coach came back and said, hey, with this feedback, this is their interpretation. And since then I've called it your leadership shadow, unintended perception based upon how you show up. Like you intend to be one thing and people read it differently. And they never knew I was an introvert. They didn't know I had a checklist. They didn't know I was a new mom. They didn't know that doing something after work means I wasn't feeding my kids, right? And seeing my baby, whatever that thing was. They didn't know I ate by myself for 30 minutes to get my energy back up. They didn't know that social events unstructured scare me and I sweat. Like I can't do chit chat. I'm uncomfortable.
Yeah.
So I had to disclose to them my personality and personal part of my life. Lesson one. And they were shocked. And I'm like, there's a lot of us quieter people, but okay. And so, but I learned how to be more out there with who I was. And then I was at LinkedIn, funny enough, and there was top 200 leaders in a room. We're doing this amazing development couple of days. And I tend to, when I'm not in an instructor role, sit in the back of the room. And there's like five of us leaders, the head of engineering. I mean, you can look at the persona and we nod at each other. We're near the exit. We're the introverts.
You're practically at the door, right?
Yes, introverts unite at the back. And so one of the leaders that happened to come in from the restroom was very extroverted, said, "Wadors, what are you doing back here?" I'm like, "Oh, us introverts, we're hanging out." And he was like, "What? You're an introvert?" I'm like, "Oh, yeah. If I don't have a role, if I'm not doing something at that table or leading the talk, I need to reserve my energy for when I have to give."
Yeah.
Because I didn't know you were an introvert. And I go, "Yeah, always have, always will." And he was like, "I swear more than half of my team are introverted. They will be amazed to see how you became an executive in Silicon Valley as an introvert." And he forced me to talk about it. He forced me to write about it. He begged, and like, he pinged me every day for 5 days straight until I wrote my first LinkedIn blog. So even as an introvert, I wasn't a blogger or a writer to broad, because, you know, introverts don't tend to want to do that as much. And I put myself out there, and it has opened up doors to talk about it, to realize that people struggle thinking it's a negative and it's actually a superpower. It opened up doors and how to dance with my extroverted partners, because I always love having an extroverted friend when I have to do certain things. It opened up the door. How do you lead different people with different styles, and how do you brainstorm and get input and like all these amazing things? Like, why didn't I talk about it sooner? Always in my head. Why didn't I talk about this sooner? It needs to be talked about. So those are two reasons why.
Yeah. Yes. And you're proudly sharing it now. And I think that's a big part of now the awareness, you know, people talking about it and claiming it. And that's what you're doing. So it's interesting. I think that team that you just going back to that original team, do you think they were mostly extroverts on that team, or was it a combination?
Out of the 10 folks, only two were introverted.
Oh, interesting. Okay.
And because we got in the conversation, and over 6-7 of them went to work for me again and again. Like, I ended up building the relationship and got getting to the aha moments, and the trust was built. And
yes,
I had to be vulnerable to build the trust. I had to like share so much more than they expected. And the two introverts were very curious about how I navigated this, because they always felt they had to like push really hard. They were exhausted by the end of the day.
I'm sure.
And I'm like, I can't afford to be exhausted at the end of my day. I've got a whole nother job when I go home with my babies. And so I'm like a gas tank monitoring my energy throughout the day. And I was teaching them how to do that.
Excellent. Excellent. So you were modeling that for them and coaching them. And for the extroverts, it was like, aha.
Mm-hmm. So it was two values for them. And I didn't realize that others were just getting home exhausted, empty tanked. And I'm like, yeah, I did empty tanked, and it's just gnarly going home and not having anything to give to your loved ones. And I'm like, I got to have something to give.
Do you find, or did you find throughout all your work, that when you have those combinations, you said that you love working with extroverts, that it can also be fun? Like, you guys, once you know what your kind of proclivities are, then you build the trust, and there's a little more looseness in the team.
It's so much better.
So much better. So much better. I want to wind back just a little bit. And I know I've read a little bit about your background, and you come from a large family. And you also, I was surprised to hear too, that you had, or the influences on you were your dad and your uncle were in HR.
Yes.
Did you ever think that that would be a direction you'd go into?
Not in the beginning, because my dad worked for General Motors with the UAW. And so union negotiation years were tough, right? And then my uncle was doing something like I thought was foreign. And then when I went into college, I got diagnosed as being dyslexic. And then I was trying to figure out what I want to be when I grew up. And they said social work, teaching this thing called HR. And I'm like, so funny, my dad and my uncle are in this space. So I interviewed them both. And what you liked, what you didn't like, tell me the raw data, like, give me what's real. Don't lie to me. And so my uncle gave me this one snippet that forever hold true today, is that 80% of a company's operational expense is the cost of talent. Mm. Mm-hmm. So if you're capital intense, it's less. If you're consulting, it's 100% cost of talent. So think of the software we use, the tools, the computers, the facilities, comp, benefits, training, development, all that's the cost of talent. And so how do you get great employees in? How do you get productivity faster? How do you get them engaged so you don't have high turnover? How do you pay them appropriately? Like all these things. And all I saw was all these bells and whistles and like a fast car. And all I want to do is have all those knobs in front of me. I wanted to run HR. And it was rare back then to have women run HR. So my uncle was like, are you sure?
Yeah. What did the women do? What were the jobs the women had?
They were benefits analysts and they were, the benefits team comp, would be it. Comp a little bit, and L&D training.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
Those tend to be men, right? The senior level comp positions were men. Yeah, like negotiating seemed to be more of a man trait, they assumed back then, like all that tough stuff that they perceived to be masculine. And yeah, I'm like, no, I got it.
I got it. I love that. I love that. And I'm having been in internal in some of those roles. I know what it took for you. I mean, I can guess. I don't know exactly your story, but that it took a lot of relationship building for you in those different roles. So talk about, you know, that one of the strengths of introverts that we've observed and people talk about is that one-on-one focused conversation, that depth that folks go into. And also you have a strategic mind. I know that too. So you kind of had the big picture of your organizations and kind of not just looking at it with HR. So, you know, I'm sure you had conversations with and developed relationships with people outside of HR, right?
A lot. So I'm endlessly curious because I think differently and I process differently. I have been shameless in always asking for help. Like that's part, like if you think about superpowers, being an introvert gives me a lot of strengths. Being dyslexic taught me to ask for help and not be afraid to go audit my data, audit my work. How would you do this differently? Like, so most people want to show strength. I was okay showing weakness. And I didn't see it as a weakness. I just saw it as a way to ensure quality.
Yeah.
So I just came out as a natural DNA. And then being an introvert, going deep on a relationship, like, do you mind helping me? Here's why I need the help.
Mm-hmm.
What can I do for you? How do you do this? What, like, I'm curious. I want to learn. And I think the ability for an introvert to listen.
Mm-hmm. How has that helped? How has that been? I mean, we say that a lot, right? That engaged listening is so critical for everybody, right? But how has that really been a benefit? How do you see that as a benefit for introverts? And extroverts need to learn it. In my opinion, we do.
They say, I forget which study, but introverts make outstanding sales reps, right? Outstanding customer partners. And I went into sales and I could see the difference. And if I, my younger self, what I saw, what I interpreted was an extroverted peer, I could see their mind working on what they're going to say next. What am I going to say next? And my mind is, what are they telling me? I'm trying to understand what they're telling me. I'm trying to hear what their needs are. And before I answer, and introverts tend to repeat back, like, Jennifer, you said the following, do you mean this? I'm seeking clarity before I respond to you. You know, versus I assume I know what you want and jump in.
Yeah.
So I think our quieter voices help us listen more. And because we're processing a lot of different things at one time, we want to make sure we're tracking on the right thing. Where an extrovert already assumes they're tracking on the right thing.
It's interesting. Yeah. They book that To Sell as Human. I think you may be familiar with that Dan Pink wrote. I believe, yes. Yeah. Wrote a couple, you know, he talked about that pair, those pairs that work. And yeah. I've noticed that too in some of my research, that the introvert and extrovert pair, because the extrovert can go and do the, you know, the big, the trade show thing. And the introvert's really getting down to it and delving deep, like you're saying, Pat. So it's like, I look for those partnerships, you know?
Me too.
I think it's really interesting, that whole engaged listening. I think it's going to be a never-ending journey for a lot of us who don't. What would be your advice to your talkative, enthusiastic, you know, folks within your company and in the world and just out there, what might you tell extroverts regarding what they need to do to really make kind of set the stage for introverts to shine?
They all want to influence. We all do. So what I tell them is repeat what you just thought you heard in your understanding of it in your language. Echo for understanding before you give your idea. if you can echo, even for like a summarization, someone talked 5 minutes, you can echo back in 3 sentences, 4 sentences, and then go do your spiel. You will have bought so much more credibility than just going into your solutioning. Because the audience may not think you actually heard, because they're seeing what I'm seeing, you're processing. Like, you want to talk now, you want to talk now. But if they see you going, look, what you just said got me excited. Here's what I think you just said to me. And here's what I'm thinking about right now with your energy is powerful. Heard, seen in an audience is like incredibly attractive to anybody.
That's that old skill we learn in communications 101. But what is it? Paraphrasing is really kind of what you're talking about, right? And I found it's interesting. Introverts can use this as a tool. We talked about earlier about practical solutions. You know, when they're in, they don't know what to say, let's say in one of those social interactions, right? Paraphrase, like you were saying earlier. And it's kind of, I always say it buys time, right? Too. Like, so you can kind of get your thoughts together, like you were saying. So what else do I hear about a lot? Meetings is a bugaboo. First of all, I think we have too many of them. Do you agree? There's too many meetings or not really?
I think we have too many poorly run or structured meetings where you over-invite or under-invite and you don't have the rigor to close on the quality of the outcome of the meeting. I think it's not a volume. It's how you're running the meeting.
How you're running them. And they're so poorly run, right?
Yeah.
I'm really amazed at that, how few agendas there are. So we talk about when you run meetings or, you know, so in order to get, this is coming from the question that I get, you know, I think about the things that people are concerned about individually who are introverted, who say they get the feedback on their performance reviews, right? You don't speak up enough at meetings.
I want to hear more from you.
I want to hear more from you, you know? And so how do they do that without taking over the room? But you're saying one of the things I think you're saying too is a well-run meeting. So I'd love to hear what would a well-run meeting look like where you're engaging all personality types? Like, what do you try to do there?
Well, there's a couple of tips and tricks. So for a well-run meeting, it really depends on the content and the desired outcome. Are you just informing? Are you rumbling to co-create something or gathering input for you to make a decision later? Or is this decision meeting, right? That you hear?
Yeah.
So be clear on what it is and what you want out of the meeting so people know. And then being clear that people have permission. If you don't think you're valid in this room, if it's not critical to you in this room, you don't have to stay in the meeting. So people have choice whether or not they stay in that conversation or not. Right. So people have to elect in. If you elect into a meeting, I think your attentive scale would increase. No, I chose to be here. I'm gonna listen. So that's the hygiene stuff.
Yeah. Yeah. Meeting hygiene is maybe you can explain people that aren't familiar with that term.
So like have an agenda in advance for introverts. If there's something I want to rumble on, gosh, I'm going to send you that material in advance, at least 2 days in advance, because you want to process, you want to think, you want to have some questions lined up. You're going to highlight a few things. I love a good agenda. So when I get a good agenda, I will highlight those two topics. I make sure I have my voice heard. There might be 8 things on that agenda, but there's 1 or 2 that get my fancy. I'm going to use I love colors. I mean, you're going to laugh at me, but in my
all
colors.
And I'm the same way.
Yeah, I'm going to highlight those topics that I'm passionate about, and I'm going to put annotate next to it questions. I want to learn more or your statement on X, depending on what the proposal was. So I've framed some thinking already. So when I get in the room, I don't get antsy that I'm not prepared to speak as an introvert. Mm-hmm. I can be present, listening to all the input, but I know when you hit these two things, I'm going to have the courage to add. The other tip I have for introverts is that even on the other 4 items that you didn't annotate in advance of that amazing agenda you just received, I would say that if you think that the conversation would be better served because you have a point of view and or you have a role in executing something, you needed better clarity, that if you think it more than twice, I started with 4 times.
The book, I think I quoted you as 4 times.
Started with 4 times. If it was 4 times, because I did a check mark on my paper. Oh, that I think that could be better. Check. I really think it'd be better. Check. Check. Like on the 4th time, I'm like, all right, fine. I have to go back to a topic. Like I give myself permission to go back and course correct and say, look, I got a question. I got a comment. because I think it needs to be said. I've shortened that now to two to speed my courage up. Just be aware of yourself. And that makes sure that you don't leave the room feeling you could have moved the needle better. It's like your input, your influence score. The other thing is, and this is a trick. This is a great trick. There's times in a meeting that I really am comfortable with everything that's being said, and I don't need to say anything more.
You know, by the way, I just have to interject, an extrovert would never say that. Right? They always have to have some kind of input. Anyway, there are sometimes you say you don't have anything to add.
Nothing to add. I'm not a pile of honor. I did nothing to add, people. And so
I love it.
What I will do though, because your leader is saying, I want to hear more from you. Those are the means like you didn't add any value, you didn't add anything, I'm not even sure you committed. Like they can misinterpret your quietness.
Yeah.
So I started applying this trick. In these conversations where I'm sure they're impactful, it's important, and I'm a leader, I will use my body language to demonstrate buy-in.
Mm.
I will lean in. I'll nod my head. I'll take a note.
Yeah.
I don't have to say a word. I'm leaning back. I'm thinking like, oh. So I exaggerate what I'm thinking with my body.
Yeah. And that works.
All the time. It was so funny. I experimented. I didn't talk for four meetings. Kid you not. Four meetings in a row because we were building on a strategy. And I thought the conversations were going great. I was still learning, still processing. We had like four more to go, but we're halfway through this sprint or marathon. And my boss to me goes, thank you for all your participation. I almost died. I'm like...
I think a lot of introverts will love hearing that. And they probably already have, right? That's incredible. So the body, now, how about on a virtual call?
Same thing. I literally pick up a pen. So it's, you see it in the Zoom.
I see you doing that now, picking up a pen.
Pick up a pen.
Huh?
It shows engagement, intentionality. Your body's going to write something down. You're hearing something and you nod and you put your head down and you nod.
I love it.
I can show my engagement without having to say a word.
Yes. Yes.
Now, if you're pressed,
because
some leaders, extrovert leaders, gosh, I worked with a couple of them. They're amazing, but they drain me.
Yeah.
Insist everyone around the horn says something. Everyone's got to talk. So our questions are our best friends. A question, if you're thinking about our gas tank of energy as an introvert, statements, giving thoughts, proposals, conclusions takes a lot more energy.
Yes.
A question is half the energy for me.
Yeah. A good question too. You probably have to ask a good question.
Yeah, but it's half the energy.
Yeah, because half the energy.
A lot of them in our heads already. Questions are like common in our brains. So
yeah.
So I will have a question or two like that without sweating, without feeling anxious. And so if I get put on the spot, what are you thinking? I say, well, I actually have a question. I would like to know more of the following.
Mm.
And then lean back.
And then you lean back. No, I love what you say about the energy drain. There was, yeah, for sure. Because you said something also about we'd rather communicate more effectively by prioritizing the opportunities or topics we wish to dedicate our energy to, being fully informed and prepared before doing so. So that idea of energy, coming back to the introvert, having a certain reserve, right, of energy. Any quick thoughts for the extrovert who is observing all of this and needs to, those extroverted leaders who are demonstrating what we found, a term that came up in the last research was loudership, that they thought that was leadership. I know it was used very commonly in one company, in jest, but not really, you know? So in those meetings, you know, that's a matter of, I guess I was wondering what you, are you modeling? Is that part of what this change agent idea is about?
Yeah. So I couple of tips for that one for sure. So 20% of the voices dominate 80% of the room.
Yeah.
And it actually makes a lot of us quieter when they do that, especially if they're more aggressive in style. We tend to shut down because the energy does change their direction is harder.
Right.
And so out of empathy for that, it's easier for me to be an advocate for somebody else. So if a quieter voice was trying to speak up and they've been spoken over more than once, I will have energy and then some to say, hey, excuse me, I really want to hear what Susie has to say or Paul has to say. We keep interrupting them. I don't call anyone out. I just say we. Mm-hmm. My language is not that aggressive, but I say we keep interrupting X, Y, Z. I want to hear what they have to say. Can we pause for a moment? Because I think they're onto something. And usually that only takes one disruptive space. Then everyone is very conscious of interrupting somebody else. So if you can be an advocate earlier on in the pattern, it becomes less awkward later in the meeting. So be an advocate for somebody else is number one. Number two, if you are the leader and you tend to be verbal, write the initials of the people around the table with you, the 8 to 10 people in that meeting, and put a check mark each time Tony talks or Susie talks, the loud ones, right? And then be conscious that of the quieter ones and then give them the signal and say, hey, look, Paul, I think we got your point of view. I'd like to hear the other voices for a while to make sure we're rumbling enough diverse thoughts. So if we're not touching on what you really care about, we'll close with you, Paul, to make sure you get heard again. And so he knows he's going to have a catch-up opportunity, but you created space for others to talk.
Again, once again, Pat, data, right?
Yes.
I realize we're getting kind of close to the end of the session, but I did want to ask you, you're in the company that you're with now, UKG, is really, I'd love you just to say a word or two about that and how you see yourself fitting into that whole development of that company of workforce solutions.
Yeah, they're pretty awesome. So I was on the board, full disclosure, and asked to come down into the operating job. Asked for a couple of reasons. One, because they were still figuring out the merger of these two amazing companies, Ulti and Kronos. They acquired Great Place to Work, and they were about to embark on a CEO transition that we announced last July. And so I love gnarly change. I love cultures that want to become great, and they had great tenants across them. They also have a culture of a lot of care. I can do a lot with a caring company, a lot.
I love that. That's a good quote. I can do a lot with a caring company.
Yeah. And so they have a product that cares about people at work, right? They work with customers, my peers. It's like working with my peers from enterprise side to small business. And if you think about creating solutions that enable them to care for their employees, I feel like I have a ripple effect sitting at UKG.
Yes.
I can take care of a high-performing, healthy company like UKG. I can role model it. I can do a lot with care, like I said. And then through their lessons, imagine how they develop the products. I'm eating in my own restaurant. So whatever we develop, I'm gonna use for my own employees. And I'm going to tell those stories, the good, bad, and the indifferent to my customers, because I want them to be wildly successful too. And so for me, it's a way to live my purpose on steroids, truth be told.
It really is. And, you know, my dad always said, make a difference. And it seems like your career has just been about that theme. You know,
it's what I love.
Yeah, I love it. And if people could see your face now smiling and happy, that's how we all should be when we think about work. So is there anything else that we haven't covered that you'd love to just let people know about the theme of being an ally for introverts in the workplace as we kind of expand this whole movement, this revolution?
Yeah, so in this learning that I have, that people really struggle with leading introverts, pulling the most out of them. They thought they wanted more of their voices. And I'm like, what you want is feel their impact. It doesn't always have to be a voice, right? You can read it. You can see it in different ways. Like, what does that look like? So I created quiet circles. I worked with quiet ambassadors to teach others how to lead introverts, be an introverted leader, be an extroverted leader of introverts, just kind of make it normalized. And when I have to socialize, I have to go to my sales kickoff meetings and meet sales teams. Gosh, they are so extroverted, the majority of them. That
yeah.
I get a partner, an extrovert partner, to come with me on those unstructured moments intentionally. Can you be my dance partner for this event? I need to meet with these 5 folks. I need to work the room, but I need to be gone an hour and a half because I will have no energy for the next day. But I want to be engaged, and I will talk to 2 people in a corner for the whole hour and a half if you don't help me network. Help me ease in and out of conversation so I don't feel so rude. And they're like, gotcha.
They love doing that, right?
They love it. I mean, they know how to like transition me. Like, I'd love to talk to you for 2 more days, but I have to go and I don't feel guilty. And it just...
Right. No, that's what they thrive on. The more people, the more connections. Super. Was there something else that you wanted to share?
When a quiet person talks, really seek to understand what they're trying to say, because it's taking them a lot more energy to build up that muscle when they want to be heard and how they're going to be heard. And so your best reaction is a question and or thank you for their feedback.
Your best reaction is a question or thank you for their feedback. I think that's a wonderful place to end our discussion today, which could go on a lot longer, but we will come back to you, Pat. This was so, so wonderful to hear. I'm inspired by you and by your advocacy and your willingness to really be transparent with everything. So thank you so much for joining us on the Introvert Alley podcast.
My pleasure. Thank you for being a champion of us too.
You're very, very welcome. It's my pleasure. That wraps up another episode of the Introvert Ally podcast. Thanks so much for listening. If you found value from our podcast, we'd love you to subscribe, rate, and review us on your favorite platform. Also, please do share it with others. Thanks, and I'll see you next time.